Thanks for the patient hearing on a Sunday evening. Very precious to all of us. I really appreciate and I thank IMA Kodambakkam for giving me this opportunity to be with this August gathering. Really, really appreciate being with such learned physicians and so motivated to learn. This is totally a different track that we are moving on to from various topics that we went into. This is really more a tertiary care from a preventive aspect, which was so scintillatingly spoken just before me, to a very different topic of treating a very advanced heart disease, heart failure, not just with medicines, where medicines are proven and beneficial, but beyond medicines, what else we have to offer. I thought I'm finding less awareness about these, so I thought as it's onus to, as an electrophysiologist with interest in this, I thought I'll just have an overview of this topic. It has a place and it has a definitive place, provided we read it and it can translate into a patient's benefit. So beyond, in addition to optimal medical therapy is the firm basis. Definitely every patient with heart failure, or whether it's symptomatic or asymptomatic, would require medication lifelong, and that would mean ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, diuretics, digoxin and spironolactone. These five drugs definitely recommended. But beyond that, what are the advances that you would like to be aware of which can benefit a patient with this dismal disease? Is I would like to speak as devices. Devices would mean as instruments like pacemakers, would be cardiac resynchronization therapy, which is a specialized pacemaker. So is an implantable defibrillator, and novel therapies which are coming up and which we will be hearing more and more as special pacemakers which stimulate the vagus nerve and apparently treat the heart failure well. But speaking about the proven therapies first, across the board, from asymptomatic left ventricular dysfunction to symptomatic heart failure to various stages, NYHA class 2 to 3, including some patients in class 4, you would like to recommend a biventricular pacemaker, and I would really, really like to highlight the use of a bi-V pacemaker for patients' heart failure to improve, and actually for heart dysfunction to reverse and become normal. It is something to be seen, to be believed, and it's not an exaggeration. So I'm really motivated to get this to everybody's awareness. So what is cardiac resynchronization therapy? We call that by this sophisticated name for atrial synchronous biventricular pacing. Normally we pace the right atrium, right ventricle. In this modality with patients with left ventricular dysfunction, we pace the left ventricle with an additional lead. As I can see in the x-ray, you have a right atrial lead, right ventricular lead, and you have an additional lead going through the coronary sinus into to pace the left ventricle epicardially. Can be done most often, 90% of the cases cardiologist does it. 10% of the times we do need help of a cardiothoracic surgeon to put in the epicardial valve when the venous access is not successful. And where do we put this, when do we think of such a sophisticated therapy? It does cost money, a minimum of 2.5 lakhs. When should we think of it? When ejection fraction is less than 35%, so-called severe ventricular dysfunction, any class of any symptomatic class, in which you have class 2, 3 and 4, definitely class 2 and 3. When patients are more advanced in disease, obviously it's almost totally far gone LV, and the reversibility would be that much more difficult. But if you can get it in class 3 and class 2 and class 3 stages, it's really good. Patients should have one criteria which is important, that is they should have a wide QRS with typically the latest guidelines say it should be left bundle branch block. QRS duration should be at least 120 milliseconds or more, and definitely present recommendations are more stricter that it should be 150 milliseconds on optimal medical. This is over and beyond on optimal medical therapy when they continue to be symptomatic and the ventricle continues to be dysfunctional. And this is the dyssynchrony that you're seeing in the MRI gated pictures. This is how the normal ventricle should be. It's easy to appreciate, whether it's difficult to define it very specifically, it's very easy to appreciate. But by guidelines, when we say dyssynchrony, we only mean electrical dyssynchrony. That means there's left bundle branch block. Left bundle branch block accentuates the normal late activation of the posterolateral area. Normally in normal sinus rhythm with no electrical conduction problem, still the left, the basal left ventricle in the lateral area is the last to get activated. In LVVV, that getting activated gets much more later, more than 40 milliseconds, and that's disynchrony. So electrical disynchrony, when patient has LVVV, that is considered electrical disynchrony. And studies clearly have shown that that translates into mechanical disynchrony. And you can clearly conceptualize that when left bundle is contracting later, while the RV is contracting and relaxation, the LV contractility is yet to occur. There's very little time left for LV to relax when it's actually not feeling well. And so a lot of hemodynamics get totally perturbed with that single electrical problem. How common is it? We're just talking of esoteric things, or is it really common to have a bundle branch block in a patient with heart failure? It definitely is common. Studies have, very, very old studies have shown that it's as common as 30 to 50%, and the occurrence, the incidence of a bundle branch block or widening of QRS increases with the longer duration of ventricular dysfunction or more progression to more severe cardiac enlargement. The bundle branch block becomes much, much more common. So 50%, 30 to 50% of your patients are of heart failure patients, or whether symptomatic or asymptomatic, or patients with LV dysfunction are going to have this, which means that they are the patients who might benefit from a BIV pacing. And I think it's much, much less utilized than what it should be. How does it matter if somebody has a ventricular how does it matter if they have a LVVV? Actually, not only left bundle branch block, even patients with much more benefiting are patients with LVVV and increased PR. PR interval at the upper limit of normal. These patients have reduced atrial kick, they have reduced preload, which brings down the cardiac output. They have more prolonged mitral regurgitation, again leading to decreased cardiac output, and LV filling is compromised with all this. How do we diagnose this? After the ECG, we take one mechanical parameter into criteria. So when we have an ECG showing a bundle branch block or a wider QRS in a patient with LV dysfunction, that is ejection fraction less than 35%, we check on echo if there is a region which is contracting later than 40 milliseconds compared to, especially if the posterolateral region is contracting more than 40 milliseconds compared to septum, then that patient has disynchrony by criteria. It is very simple on an M-mode. M-mode is the first and basic echo analysis that we do, and when we see that the inward motion of the septum is, the peak inward motion is 40 milliseconds ahead of the peak inward motion of the posterior wall, that itself is confirmatory that this patient is likely to respond to a BIV pacing very well. Tissue Doppler gives it in a more finer way, all the milliseconds criteria, but while that is gives you a more detailed picture, but simply 2D echo and MOT give you as much information in a usual case. Just to talk of so far evidence-based medicine, you see that big studies, Maastricht and Miracle, these are multi-center studies. They showed categorically that patients with biventricular pacemaker improve in symptoms, quality of life, improve objectively in exercise tolerance, and there's definite decrease in hospitalizations. All of us would be very, very happy when you have these patients coming for recurrent inotropic infusions. As much as that, people who have so much advanced disease can also benefit from BIV pacemaker. I can't tell you how rewarding it can be when you see such patients. More than that, and beyond that, is that it's clearly shown to reverse the remodeling. The LV, which was so dilated and baggy, actually starts improving. The end systolic volume comes down, and that's one of the ways the responder is defined, the reduction in end systolic volume by 10%. So clearly, biventricular pacing decreases the end systolic volumes, and when switch off the pacing, the end systolic volumes go up again, similar to MR. Both end systolic volumes, end diastolic volumes, as well as mitral regurgitation improve very well with BIV pacing. But beyond that, we're all, as clinicians, would like to somehow contribute to improving the survival in such a dismal disease as heart failure, and bilateral pacing clearly has shown to improve survival, decrease mortality, and that's we're not talking of small returns then. If you consider the cost and the returns, returns definitely overweigh, the benefits are really, really good. ECG synchronization pre-CRT, you can see the wide QRS is left, typical left bundle branch block sinus rhythm which is there in this patient, and post bilateral pacing the QRS definitely narrows, indicative of whenever we have this simple criteria that post implantation of CRT there is ECG narrowing that usually translates into not only symptomatic benefit but actually LV coming down in its volumes and improving in its ejection fraction. So should why we are not recommending to everybody then, if 50% of people are eligible for this, why we are not? So let's think of the adverse events apart from the economic issues, and most commonly is the lack of belief that this will work. Even in amongst cardiologists, there's really no belief that it will work. I really would like you to be open to it, that it really works, and in such a really hardly any options disease like heart failure, if you've exhausted all the reversible causes, given optimal therapy, a good trial, if you're still finding ventricle to be dysfunctional, something you really need to consider in a patient with wide QRS, because that's the basis. Electrical dyssynchrony is still the basis for giving a CRT. We should think, what are the problems which we can, which kept most of the cardiologists away, is that lead can get dislodged. The left ventricular lead doesn't have as much secure lodging as the usual right atrial and right ventricular leads, because you're in the epicardial veins which don't have any valves, and so they can move. There can be a phrenic stimulation very common, which can inconvenience a patient with diaphragmatic twitching. And because these coronary veins are very tiny, and the coronary, so they can dissect while implantation. These are like, but considering that, it depends definitely on the operator. And now we have leads which are having their own ways of securing with their own curves. It comes with a pre-shaped curves to anchor it well. So this is a patient with severe heart failure, ejection fraction of 20%. You can see that a bilateral pacing is immediate post-op X-ray shows definite cardiomegaly, LV contour, atrium is enlarged, and you see 6 months later, definitely the cardiomegaly is much less. And this is not really theoretical or once in a way patient. When they respond very, very significantly, and it can really make us feel good about it. There are trials which show that even relatively mildly symptomatic patients can behave. So now actually latest guidelines include minimal symptoms also. Patients with minimal exertion induced dyspnea, fatigue, any effort or intolerance should be given a bilateral pacemaker. So again, to reiterate, patients who require a bilateral pacemaker are those whose ejection fractions are less than 35%, who are symptomatic, who have a left bundle branch block with QRS duration of 120 milliseconds at least, or a stricter criteria of 150 milliseconds, should be given a bilateral pacemaker. Moving on to a cardioverter defibrillator, it's in a specific subset of patients with ventricular dysfunction who benefit from this to prevent sudden cardiac death. Even without ventricular dysfunction, in certain electrical problems like channelopathies, like Brugada, long QT, it is helpful. It is the only thing that we have in our hands to prevent suddenly patient having a cardiac death. And but predominantly 99% of implants occur in patients with LV dysfunction, because by incidence that's the commonest diagnosis. And why is sudden cardiac death so common? Because sudden cardiac death occurs in heart failure almost 6 to 9 times than in general population. And even without heart failure, just patients with myocardial infarction and ventricular dysfunction, when ejection fractions are less than 40%, they have a very high death rate. In fact, most of the post MI deaths are most commonly when patients suddenly collapse 10 years after a previous myocardial infarction. It's often, you know, that it's because patient has had an arrhythmic death, arrhythmic cause, and that's one of the most common ways that people die. When you think they're well treated, after an MI, they underwent an angiogram, it showed some mild disease or some recanalized LAD, that kind of thing, and you've given adequate drugs, statins, antiplatelets, beta blockers, still you find that suddenly the patient collapses, and you find that sudden death is very, very common in a scar. Previous scar, when it is there, it's very arrhythmogenic, and while drugs are good to decrease the frequency, they are not completely curative, so ICD is mandatory in such population. In India, we don't go by the MADIT 2 criteria, wherein in US, because it's still insurance is there to provide for every patient who has ventricular dysfunction following an MI, they give a defibrillator. Because it's expensive for us, we give it as a secondary prophylaxis. A patient with ventricular dysfunction, when they have had at least one episode of ventricular tachycardia, which means that they have a very high risk of having it occur again in the next 1 year, at least 50% chance of it occurring again in 1 year, which means that they have 50% chance of dying suddenly in the next following 1 year, then we recommend strongly. So primary prophylaxis is less in India, but it's the AHA guideline that any patient with ventricular dysfunction following previous myocardial infarction, you should recommend, at least you should recommend when the patient gets it, because it is expensive. It's about, again, like a biventricular pacemaker, it costs a minimum of 2.5 lakhs. So, but then in India, people can afford many, many lakhs for even a function like a death function in the family. So I guess it's just a priority that we need to give. So first of all, again, physicians should feel motivated to suggest. And so again, the awareness of it is important. Arrhythmic causes, when person collapses suddenly and dies suddenly, if, as we define sudden cardiac death, without any, without expecting them to die, if suddenly somebody collapses within 1 hour, they die. So if that is the stricter definition, then you see that it's 90% of times because of an arrhythmia. What arrhythmia? VT 60% of times, VF 10%, polymorphic VT in 13%, and bradycardia is about 20%. So always predominantly arrhythmic in nature, and arrhythmic deaths in, across the board are very, very common causes of mortality. Then if you see the numbers needed to treat with an ICD is much, much less. You just need to give 3 patients a defibrillator to prevent death, compared to treating somebody with amiodarone, you need to treat 37 patients to prevent therapy. So that way, treated when you pick up your patients, well, this is a very much needed treatment. It was first conceptualized by Dr. Michel Mirosky. He was in Israel. He saw a senior colleague collapse suddenly, and that motivated him. It's a single person's motivation, actually, which he moved across to US. There was a very, very stiff opposition to this idea that defibrillator should be miniaturized and implanted in a... He was really very aghast that he didn't have an external defibrillator in hand to protect his colleague from death. And it was against a very, very stiff opposition that he got this, and it's now today saved many, many thousands of lives. Initially it was given only for survivor of cardiac arrest. In fact, in 1995, when it was approved by FDA, it was a very strict criteria that it should be given to survivors of 2 cardiac arrests. But now, after the indications that any patient with ventricular dysfunction, no prior cardiac arrest is to be given a defibrillator. There is significant reduction in mortality, especially when you give for primary prophylaxis, almost 60% benefit in improving survival, compared to patients who are already far gone and who had VT and resuscitated. They have less reduction, because then their mortality from heart failure starts going up. What does the defibrillator do? It's an advanced pacemaker, very, very advanced computer, very intelligent computer. It can tire its, there are various tires or steps in which it gives therapy. When there is organized ventricular tachycardia, it gives an anti-tachycardia pacing and terminates. And when there is usually following a VT, there is some bradycardia, it paces to maintain rhythm. When it's fast VT, when it's very fast ventricular tachycardia above the cutoff, then it gives a low energy shock. These usually, both these therapies are not failed by a patient. When it's ventricular fibrillation, it delivers a defibrillation shock which is felt like a thud by patient. It's usually in the range of 30 to 35 joules and rescues the patient from collapsing. This is how a defibrillator strip looks. This is how the defibrillator looks like, a slightly bigger than a pacemaker. A single lead with a shock coil goes into the right ventricle. And this is sinus rhythm and VF occurring, and device senses it. And shocks and sinus rhythm is restored. Then should it not be given? Where it has not shown benefit is that if patients, CABG patch trial has shown that patients with ischemic heart disease should be first revascularized well, and only if then symptoms are occurring, then patients within the first 40 days after myocardial infarction, please do not give for primary prophylaxis. It also benefits in dilated cardiomyopathy. Would like to touch vagus nerve stimulation because it's not yet clinical, but just to say that there are a lot more things in horizon: renal denervation, radio frequency ablation to bring down VT burden and all. But vagus nerve stimulation by a special pacemaker helps, has shown in a short term, even at 6 months, has shown to, whenever you increase a parasympathetic dominance, bring down the sympathetic dominance, that is proved beneficial, and definitely it's translated into hard endpoints of decreasing the LV end systolic volumes and improving ejection fraction in a cohort of 32 patients. Thank you.
Thank you, great for my talk, madam. Floor is open for discussions. There are 2 minutes for discussion.
Regarding this ICD you are telling, most lethal tachyarrhythmias can be tackled by this ICD. Some of the many of the diabetic patients develop sudden cardiac death. That is due to cardiac standstill. It fails to contract. Do you think this will help, this device will help in such patients?
LV dysfunction due to any cause, ventricular dysfunction, if it is there, ejection fraction 40% or less. Usually diabetics have non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, so ejection fractions are less because of non-ischemic reasons, and ejection fraction of 35% or less in these patients. Or if they have Holter showing, Brad is not, you need to rule out 2 things. And even in diabetics, you need to rule out silent ischemia as a cause, because they have a higher incidence of silent ischemia, which can lead to polymorphic VT. And with the end result may be a Brad, but before that, what caused to Brad is to see. Defibrillators have a backup ventricular pacing. So every ICD can also work as a Brad backup. For a bradycardia also, it will protect. But primarily, without any ventricular dysfunction, there is no role for giving a defibrillator for a diabetic patient.
But this is not just ischemia alone. It can be cardiac autonomic neuropathy. That causes the cardiac standstill.
Still, if you see across sudden cardiac death due to bradycardia, has only 18% incidence. So, still not the main.
Thank you very much, madam. We come to the